coming in, of course. The sign-in sheet is being passed around. Just make sure to sign in. And I'm really honored to introduce you to Dr. David Rhew. He is the Chief Medical Officer and Head of Healthcare and Fitness for Samsung Electronics of America. So he has received an MD from Mount Sinai.
Northwestern,
and has done internal medicine residency from Mount Sinai. He does a lot of work focusing on thinking about how U.S. technology and creating patents that can enable the authoring, mapping, and integration of clinical decision support into the electronic health record. He can tell you a lot more about all of his work in electronics than I can, so excited to hear him speak.
Great. Can you guys hear me all right? Sound okay? Let me just check. And there's folks that are being, this is being live streamed too. Is there a certain place that I need to stand to make sure I don't get out of the Zoom? That's okay. So I'm hearing a lot of static here. Let me see if I can switch out.
That would probably.
Did that work?
Yeah, maybe remove the other mic. I think it's, or.
Sorry, a
little technical difficulties here. Do I even need a mic?
I think
it's good
for the stream. Okay.
Thank you.
How about now? Maybe if I hold it lower, a little better.
Oh, the sound's great.
Sounds good here?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll just hold it like this then. Okay. Hi, everyone. My name is Dave Rhew. I'm the Chief Medical Officer for Samsung. I think most of you know Samsung for our smartphones, for our tablets, for our TVs. Home appliances, but what you may not realize is that Samsung actually has a deep and long-standing commitment to healthcare. I'm curious in terms of the sound. Is that still sound okay?
It's perfect.
Sounds kind of like a little bit of an echo. A good example would be in 1994, Samsung established the Samsung Medical Center. It's a large tertiary care facility based in South Korea. It's probably one of the more technologically advanced centers where we have really look to see different ways that technology can improve the patient experience. So a couple of examples, if you were to go to the Samsung Medical Center and you wanted to set up an appointment, you can do that via your phone. You can, similar to how we do a lot of these scheduling online, you can do that. When you go in, there's an ability for you to see where you are on the wait list. So if you were to go to an airport and you wanted to get an upgrade, you can kind of see how where you're at. It allows you to be able to determine how long you've actually been in this room and how long people need to, in terms of like being able to more in a more timely manner see you. And the doctors can come in and they can do prescribing via the mobile phone and a variety of other things. So what we found is that the mobile technologies can be quite helpful in the hospital setting. But one of the things that we have also discovered is that a lot of healthcare today is moving outside of the hospital. And because of that, there is a very strong desire to understand how these technologies, specifically the consumer-based technologies, can be used to improve health outcomes. So improve access to care, quality of care, reduce costs, and overall patient experience, making that a better experience for all. So in talking to many organizations across the country, we have come to the realization that there is a lot of really exciting research going on, many of which is stuff that people are not even aware of. So what I thought I'd do today is talk a bit about some of that real exciting research and specifically highlight some of the things that today are disruptive. And so what I mean by disruptive, I mean these are things that will completely change the way that we think of how technology is used in medicine, how consumers and their roles are, and what we need to do is we need to understand and recognize that this is potentially a new way of implementing medical solutions. So when we've been looking at this space, there's three general areas, specifically in the hospital, that we think that these disruptive technologies can take place. Outside of the hospital, specifically using digital health technologies, this falls into a category of telemedicine, connected health, digital health sensors, and then really looking within the home. So rather than kind of going through and describing all of these, what I wanted to do is I want to highlight some of the things that are perhaps some of the most disruptive and most interesting and things that will, in many cases, surprise individuals. So let me first talk about in the hospital setting. I think virtual reality is an area where people have spent a lot of time thinking about how this can be used in the healthcare one of the areas that it's been specifically focused on is how can you improve the patient experience? So, you know, we think of VR as a great way to have an escape from reality. People can immerse themselves in an environment. We know certainly it's great for gaming. It could be great for pediatric wards, individuals that want to escape the hospital experience, at least for a few moments. We've also seen it being used in clinical training. But what we haven't recognized is that it actually can be used in quite valuable for something called therapeutic VR. The therapeutic VR is an area that is an emerging area that is specifically using virtual reality to treat medical conditions. So this is an equivalent or on par to medications, to surgeries, to a variety of things. And one of the things that we have found is that it can be highly effective in terms of reducing pain. It can reduce stress. It can reduce anxiety. And in fact, in clinical trials that are being done across the country, we're finding that a lot of this can be on par to the use of current treatments. So we may be able to decrease pain by about 24%, which is, if you were to look at what morphine does, morphine reduces around 30-35%. So really on par to high narcotics that have a high potency. Interestingly enough, we have also seen that even when you take the VR headset off, individuals will have an effect that lasts anywhere from an hour to several hours afterwards, which is surprising because you would think that simply taking off the headset, you go back into the typical pain. So what are some of these real exciting things that we're seeing? So sickle cell pancreas is a really painful condition. Individuals that have sickle cell disease, sometimes they run into an experience where their blood cells are what they call sickling, and they are creating a lot of pain because of there's a lot of stress and stress on their system. And because of when an individual has sickle cell pain crisis, what typically happens is they are admitted to the hospital, they're given IV fluids, and they're started on IV narcotics, sort of like a standard general practice. We've seen individuals with kids coming into the ER with sickle cell pain crisis and treated with VR and then sent home. So what this is doing is preventing readmission, and preventing admission, is improving the quality of care, and it's allowing people to not have to use narcotics. And today, that is a major issue. If you think about sort of one of the biggest issues that we face today, the opioid epidemic and narcotic usage is exceptionally high on the list. And what we're finding is that we need non-narcotic alternatives. So rather than me kind of explaining it too much and trying to describe what you can see, these are the types of things you can see. You can swim with the blue whale. Let me show you a video that can give you an idea of what this could look like.
Well, my name is Robert Jester. I was born, raised, and still living out on the eastern end of Long Island in a little town called Rhew. Tom Jester is this kind of exceptional guy. He was a teacher for 39 years. He won all these awards. He's a volunteer fireman. He's always helping. I also was the local chimney sweep. Last August, while I was working at a man's house, I fell from the chimney. I broke 19 bones. I had several rods put in my back. I woke up and found myself with no use of my legs and no control of anything below my waist. And that's where this adventure began. So for the past year, I've gone through surgeries, gone through 5 days a week rehab that's continued rapidly to this point. I didn't think a human could experience that much pain. That's the only way to describe it. The pain was developing to a point where I couldn't sleep at night. And the science teacher in me was always concerned about the pain medication. Because I was taking so much of it. And so I forced myself just constantly to fight every day to take less and less and less medication. I started to put together things that I could do to try to alleviate some of the pain, but at the same time not depend on the chemical meds as much. One of the weapons in my arsenal is the applied VR virtual reality. If I'm having real serious pains, I feel like I want to take another oxy. A lot of times I'll scrap it off. I can refocus my attention to flying on the right airplane or looking at animals out on the plane or looking at farm animals. And when taking my attention away from the pain, But I learned in my mind how to do that same thing for an hour or two after I used it. The future of virtual reality and healthcare is probably limitless. I think about maybe just taking people away from laying in a hospital bed for month after month after month and letting them tour a museum in Europe. You know, and how great that is. So not only pain management and not only anxiety, but also something to contribute to their mental health. Over the past 3 weeks, I went with no opioids at all, none. And I have no intention. I have no intention of staying in a wheelchair, even though doctors say, I'll show you something. That right there. Some of the doctors say I'm gonna walk. I'm just telling you, okay, you heard me. Okay. I'm gonna walk out and not land something. I'm sure.
So what's going on with this virtual reality? I think a lot of researchers have been very curious about it. So they've done functional MRIs of individuals that have pain. And you can see on the top row, when you use the functional MRIs on the brain, all that yellow represents high level of activity. And when you give the VR treatment, and even several hours afterwards, it quiets down. So clearly there's some kind of neurochemical change that's going in conjunction with the treatment. And that, in many cases, many people believe is similar to how when we have like an endorphin rush that you would get, and then you've got this mechanism where you've got an equivalent of pain medication internally surging. Now, many people that have done meditation and yoga can do this, but it's really hard for the majority of the population to be able to get into this meditative state. And VR, for some really remarkable reason, is enabling people to be able to move into the state. This is an exceptionally new area. It's cutting edge. It's stuff that we are seeing across the country they're using. I know at Stanford they're using VR. It's being used across pediatric wards. In fact, there was a woman that delivered a baby in an obstetric ward using just VR and no epidural. We've seen post-op patients using the VR, alternating it with their typical narcotics, so literally reducing the narcotic usage by 50%. So really remarkable cases of use of VR for pain management. And what we wanted to do, and we have been doing in conjunction with a lot of sites across the country, is publishing. We wanted to show that this is actually compared to a control group, resulting in these improvements. And so in large prospective controlled trials, and in fact, we just completed a randomized controlled trial at Cedars-Sinai in Los Angeles, where we compared VR with a control group. And the control group, interestingly enough, was not just your basic control group, but it was actually a group that received the same type of calming videos on a TV screen. So it wasn't really the content that was doing it. What was happening is that actually this immersive experience that's creating this therapeutic benefit. And so what we found in that clinical trial, and we're soon to be published, is that we found a significant reduction in the group receiving the VR intervention compared to the control. So really compelling data on this. Soon to be something that
you'll
see a lot more of. Yes,
David. This seems really neat. Any work in psych yet? I mean, this seems like perfect for exposure therapy, CBT, stuff like that.
Oh, absolutely. So you're bringing up some really great use cases. In fact, some of the early work in this has been done on post-traumatic stress disorder. That does a great researcher in Stanford, USC, that does a lot of this. And what they have been doing is there's exposure therapy. There's a lot of learning that we've had in terms of how VR can be used to treat psychiatric conditions and really kind of things that phobias is sort of a classic example. But this goes even beyond that, because what we're finding is that this one is creating an effect equivalent to narcotics, but at the same time it's not narcotic, and it's allowing us to be able to consider how we can use this as a tool in our fight against opioids. So really exciting stuff, a lot of different use cases. I want to share with you another interesting sidebar off this. When we had the VR being applied at Cedars, there was an individual, actually a person who was made for a transplant and was exceptionally poor, tired, depressed, because he was in this room, and for folks that are made for transplants, you kind of feel like you're locked in. There's not a whole lot you can do. your chances of rejection are increased. So they really want to make sure people are in as good a state, not only physically, but also mentally and psychologically. And this was a really effective tool for that. We have talked about training, and I think we were learning a lot more about how VR can be used for training purposes. We typically think of VR as a means to showcase a lot of different complex surgeries, but where it really is particularly valuable is team-based training. So if you need to understand how to coordinate with your surgical assistant, your nurse, and all these other things, that's where the benefit is. So it's a real life example of this. Let's say you were to go to medical school and complete your surgery training, and you're going to learn how to do a new type of procedure. So what a lot of surgeons do today is they'll go to a course, they'll maybe spend a week, learn it, and then they'll come back to the facility and say, I'm ready to do it. But typically they aren't, because it's a surgical team that needs to be learned how to do this. So they end up, you know, having the surgical team go and do take the training class. And ultimately there's a lot of time, cost, resources expended on this. This allows the VR a team to basically see the same type of surgery from different angles. So imagine cameras from a surgical perspective, from above to the top, you know, from a anesthesiologist perspective. And you can, depending on your perspective, switch from those. You can add learning modules to it. So it's a highly engaging, interactive mechanism to fully immerse yourself into these. And we're seeing this being used across the country. By the way, these are surgeons that help us call Banner in Phoenix. There's a really interesting use case for VR that is something that I don't think most people have kind of even envisioned. VR to treat and to actually improve the vision for those with blindness. So there are many causes of blindness, but clearly not all individuals with blind are completely blind. They actually, many of them actually have really bad vision to the point where they can't see. So when you get your vision is really bad, you're technically blind, even though you have still some ability to kind of discern light and things of that sort. So conditions like macular degeneration, is the condition where the middle of your visual field, imagine a little black spot there. It continues to get bigger and bigger and bigger. So it's really hard to see when you have advanced macular degeneration, because it's like, imagine if you're watching TV and you put a big black patch right in the middle. That's really what the visual field is. And then no matter where you go, you always have that big black spot. People with severe myopia, nearsightedness, it just gets so bad you can take it off and you really can't see. You have to kind of read right up here. Individuals that have cataracts, where it gets really cloudy and it's really hard to see, everything's foggy. This results in functional blindness. So what we realized is that, imagine if you could actually have a pair of corrective lenses that used artificial intelligence real time to sort of Photoshop things in front of you. You could actually correct your vision to see that. And so that was what was developed. This is something that Samsung developed, tested, and launched. It's free. It's on the Oculus Play Store. We are having clinical teams across the world starting to explore how this can be used. It's called Illumino. And what it does is it does five different things, and it depends on what your condition is. It allows you to have edge enhancement and color control. It allows you to be able to identify the edges and make them stronger and more clear. It allows you to do the blind spot remapping, which is particularly relevant for macular degeneration. We can take the picture, actually, and move it over to the side, color conversion, color filtering. And the way it works is that, imagine, so you've got the VR headset, and there's actually a camera, a smartphone that is put onto it. And if you've ever, kind of taken a picture and looked in the back of your phone, you've got a camera that's constantly pulling imagery in, and you can see it on your camera. But let's say you added an AI technology on top of this that now takes that image and auto-corrects things. And that's what this is doing. This is the auto-correction that's occurring real-time. And so what ends up happening is that when we did this clinical trial of 20 individuals who were functionally blind, and these were folks who had a vision of 2200, when they used this, they corrected to 2025, which is pretty close to correct vision, 2020 vision. So the things that they saw, to give you an idea, if this is the image on the top, this is what they're seeing on the lower left, here's what they saw. They're not perfect, but it's, in many cases, much better than what they were seeing. Particularly valuable when you're reading. So you can see the original, here's what they were seeing before, and here's kind of what it happened. So you can now actually discern the letters, which, you know, when you think about these use cases, sitting down reading a book, reading a newspaper, magazine, watching TV, interacting with individuals, how important they are. This is the macular degeneration element, the original vision. You got your blind spot in the middle, taking that imagery from the middle and real time displacing it off to the side, allowing individuals to be able to see that. So really interesting use cases there. And then some individuals have something called metamorphopsia, which is essentially a distorted or waviness to their image, their vision, and it can also be straightened. So let me show you a video to kind of give you an idea of how this is being used. So I'd like to share with you one last virtual reality example. This is really astounding. This is an example of using virtual reality to actually treat paralysis. Individuals that, and these are the clinical trials, the published clinical trial, individuals who were had spinal cord injury, eight individuals, some paralyzed for longer than 12 years, lots of bowel and bladder function. And what they did is they used something called an exoskeleton to help them walk. And they used virtual reality to kind of connect, to give them the sensation that they were walking. So imagine if you were to think about the spinal cord as a highway between the brain and your extremities and the sensors and the sensation that you have. And when you touch things, the sensations come up and it goes through the spinal cord to your brain. You can feel that. When you want to tell your hand to move, sends the signal down, it goes to the spinal cord, it goes to the motor. And so when you have an injury to that, your both your sensation and your motor oftentimes are compromised. So you're not able to basically function. And so we need paraplegics, individuals that have loss of both arms and legs with loss of bladder. So you really that state some for as long as 12 years. What they did is they looked at how the VR could train and almost trick the brain into thinking that it was actually moving. And so what they would do, in conjunction, they would move the legs and the feet. And in the process, they were regenerating nerves, neural pathways. So keep in mind, this was not a severing of the spinal cord. If you went to work every day and you drove the same freeway, and that freeway was damaged. You say, well, I can't go to work anymore for like many years. And then someone showed you a path that was no one you've ever taken before, but you just kept on taking that path. Your brain can learn that new path, and that's exactly what was happening. These individuals were learning these new paths. And what was remarkable is that at the end of this one-year trial, we had half of them, actually all of them regained function, half of them were have tremendous opportunity with this technology to do things that are remarkable and in many cases unbelievable. So let me shift gears and talk a bit more about another disruptive technology. This is about the use of sensors and wearables and a variety of other things to create what's called virtual care models. So today, healthcare is very expensive, it's inaccessible, and in many cases, it's something where we are looking to change the way that care is delivered. In order to do so, we have to kind of rethink what's the role of the hospital, the clinic, and the provider. And in many cases, we are finding that it is not necessary for individuals to come into these facilities that we deem healthcare clinics and hospitals, because the care could be delivered remotely, virtually. So starting with telemedicine visits, that would probably be the most basic example of how you can provide care. But what we're talking now about is extending beyond telemedicine visits to actually receiving a full course, a full treatment, a program that is designed around constant surveillance and tracking of certain activity to enable organizations, to healthcare providers, to be able to better manage your care. So one of the examples that we have found to be particularly relevant is in the area of cardiac rehabilitation. So these are individuals that have had a heart attack. And what happens is after you had a heart attack, generally speaking, you have to come in to a program that will last anywhere between 6 to 8 weeks. And as part of that, you will seek a trainer maybe like three times a week for about an hour, 45 minutes or so. And I think most people's impression of this program, because these are patients that just had heart attacks, is that, well, during that program, they've got like EKGs, they've got defibrillators. Well, that cannot be the case at all. In fact, the vast majority of these cases are, it's even like a low risk patient, it's just about someone just encouraging them to stay active. And in fact, if you look at the way that a lot of these programs are being implemented across the country, there, in many cases, you can telephone. It's just saying, on Monday, how far did you walk? Do you have any symptoms? On Tuesday, how far did you walk? And so today, it is not really well done. And when it is done, the completion rate for these programs is very low. So it ranges anywhere between like 10% during certain times of the year to 40%. So we worked with a program that was at 40% for a telephone triage call, a nurse call. And we said, this whole program could be virtualized on a smartwatch. And so using the smartwatch, we were able to take the core elements of the program, put it on the watch, it's actually with the Gear S2, so it's the smartwatch, and we enabled individuals to basically do this, it's called a 6-minute walk test. You walk, it determines how long you're able to walk, it checks your heart rate, asks you a series of questions about the day, gives you reminders. And this program is essentially the same type of stuff that they get when they were coming into the facility. But the difference is they didn't have to come to the facility. And so what ended up happening is that the completion rate for the program went from 48% at baseline to 83%, so we almost doubled it, which is remarkable because when we asked the cardiologist, what does that really mean? The cardiologist said that based on the systematic reviews of the literature, the randomized control trials for this, they were citing data that a number needed to treat of 4. That means for every 4 patients that complete this program, or a cardiac rehabilitation program, you are saving a life. Which is remarkable when you think about how many people are not completing the program. So huge opportunities to improve care, and they're simply not completing it because of accessibility issues, and we're making it too difficult for people to come in for prolonged periods to do this. And that's where we are recognizing big opportunities to be able to change the way that we practice medicine. And you can see the Net Promoter Scores, satisfaction scores through the roof, both on the provider as well as the patient side. So a couple of learnings that we had. One of the things was we thought maybe we could just create an app and people would just download it. But the problem with that was if the providers wanted control over the protocol. So if they wanted to change the protocol, they wanted to push out some information to everyone, they couldn't rely on individuals just downloading apps. They needed what's called mobile device management control of this. They wanted to be able to control the user experience on this. In order to do that, there had to be something called an enterprise deployment. It also recognizes that the data on this is no longer just consumer data, but it's actually health data that needs to be locked down and secured. So in working with them, we recognized there were several things that needed to be put in place, including secure a mobile system on these devices. So this is an example of Knox, which is considered today the most enterprise secure mobile platform on wearables, smartphones, and tablets, as rated by a company called Gartner. And what we realized is that security on these devices, the ability to have a customized experience, mobile device management, all critical in terms of deploying it. The reason is because today we are actually constantly at risk. This is something that most healthcare organizations have experienced at some point. 81% have had some kind of a data breach in the past 2 years. And where is it occurring? It's actually occurring at the app layer. So when we have these data breaches, what we're talking about is individuals that somehow downloaded an app and it's got created spyware or malware, and at the app layer is sending the data elsewhere. So what you really need is you need sort of a super antivirus to really kind of protect it. And that's something that we have been spending a lot of time working with young folks to create a system that protects it at all the layers. And so for those that are into the health IT aspect of this, data security, privacy, big issues nowadays. Let me close with some thoughts on another disruptive technology, and it's really about the user experience and how we transform that. So if let's say we are a hospital and we are now thinking of deploying a telemedicine program for our patients. A lot of times what happens is the patient's given a tablet or they're asked to download an app, and then they go in, what we'll do a telemedicine visit on this. But here's the challenge. 20% of seniors over the age of 85, and that's a key target because that group is the group that oftentimes is the group that is most likely to be readmitted, most likely to have multiple comorbidities, and oftentimes is the least likely to use the tab. So 20% of that group will readily use it, 80% will need assistance, will need someone to actually guide them through it, which means that there's a heavy dependence on the care provider. It could be your family member, it could be but without that, this doesn't work very well. But when we looked at the reasons why people struggled, it wasn't as what we originally envisioned. We thought it was because people could just never get it. But usually they could. It was just so that they ran into a problem. They moved the icon off to the side. The screen got dim. The volume went off. They couldn't figure out what their username password was. I mean, things like that. That was the barrier. So what we realized is that there's actually 43 configurations you need to make to these technology devices to make them usable so that you can achieve high-level usability. And when we applied this usability analysis to tablets for seniors who had never used technology before or had very little exposure, in a project that we ran with the National Coalition on Aging, 225 seniors that had very little exposure, we were given these tablets, and we recognized that they actually, over a three-month period, had dramatic improvements of their understanding of how technology worked. Adoption of it went from about 0% to well over 80%. And here's what got really interesting. They actually had better health outcomes. So what was happening, because they were engaging with the technology, they started interacting with the world a lot more, and they started becoming more active because the NCOA in conjunction, the National Coalition on Aging, in conjunction with the adoption of the program, was pushing out reminders on encouraging people to stay more active, to socialize, and they even have little challenges. So let me show you a quick video, because this will kind of give you an idea of what we're talking about here.
My name is Gail McCormick. I'm 72 years old, and I live in Duxbury, Massachusetts, a beautiful town right on the coast, very friendly town. I was in a car accident back in 1992, and I had a head injury, so it left me with, I had no balance. Now, I'm limited mobility-wise, so I spend a lot of time in the house. I like to plan a couple days a week to go into the Duxbury Senior Center. I took a course there last year with a breezy tablet. I had no interest in technology. I didn't want to be proud of it, but people kept saying it was good to me, it was good to me. I had no expectations one way or the other, and I used it all the time. My house is 30 degrees, 32 degrees, inside. crazy that, you know, connection with the outside world, and that was scary. Last year, I had my tablet, and I was able to stay in contact with Joanne Moore, who's the director of the senior center. And it was really comforting because I just had that connection with somebody. And I had emergency numbers on my tablet. We felt safe. Coming in contact with my nephew after so many years, it felt like it was something that shouldn't happen. He emailed me back saying, look at you, clear the internet. And I feel kind of warm about it. I didn't think I was going to like Facebook, and then I started watching it, and I was hooked into Facebook. I really love it. And one of these days, we'll probably wait till spring, and I'm out riding around on the bus, I'll take it and take some really nice pictures of us, and looking forward to doing that. So a little more connected with the world in general. Find out things about yourself that you just weren't aware of. I love it. Yeah, I just love it. Never say never. You know, you think you're not going to like something, and make a big difference in your life.
So I presented that at a conference hosted by the American Cancer Society called Three Deals Against Cancer. And they shared with me that they have a similar type of issue, which is they have so much great content, but the problem is no one uses it when they need to use it. So an individual is actually given a diagnosis of cancer, the first thing that goes through their mind is, oh my gosh, I'm going to die. Is this real? Who do I need to talk to? And they can't process all this information that's coming in. They call it a fog. And so they realize that sometimes having access to all the information is not the right thing. What you need to do is you need to give the right amount at the right time and to digest that in small outlets, small amounts. So what we found is that if you understand the user experience of how people go through cancer, the diagnosis, the biopsy phase, the chemotherapy phase, the post-chemotherapy phase, you can understand that they have different needs and you can adjust the user content. So this is a pilot that's being done at Athens Regional where we are customizing the tablet experience to increase adoption and engagement. So really kind of what we talked about technologies today that are consumer technologies. These are all things that you can buy off the shelf at a Best Buy. You can buy it at some kind of a retail store. But they're being used in healthcare to actually improve the quality and the lives of individuals, improve access to care, improve the overall outcome, which is really exciting. It's disruptive because we're not used to the fact that when we think of technology, when we think of healthcare, it's traditionally been around standard stuff like MRI machines. But today, we're at the point where we're not starting to move outside of the hospital, and a lot of the technology that we'll experience and we'll be using and potentially prescribing to our patients will be things that will be organized in terms of comprehensive packages that can be deployed and will ultimately lead to better outcomes. Thank you very much. Happy to answer some questions if you'd like. Thanks.
So yeah, I had a question about Breezy. I was really inspired by that just because my grandmother, she has an iPad and she struggles a lot with the interface and I'm always hearing about it. So I guess I was wondering how is it a platform that one puts onto a Samsung like tablet or is it a specific kind of tablet that elderly populations use? And then I guess in terms of like costs of a lot of these things, how just in a future landscape, like in general, a lot of digital healthcare technologies, how do you see that coming into play with public health efforts?
So I'll tell you what we've been doing up to date, currently, and then our learnings and where we probably need to take it. So to date, there is oftentimes this feeling that you create technology, you give it to the consumer, and they'll get better. You create a wearable, give it to them, they'll get better. You give them a tablet, they'll be so intuitive, they'll get better. Mm-hmm. And for a certain population, it's true. They are already motivated, they will do it, it will help. But for the majority of individuals, it will not. And what we've realized is that there need to be configurations that need to be specifically adjusted. To make configurations, we're talking about locking down certain features, something we call kiosk mode, to creating certain patterns for how one interfaces the application. So a good example would be video conferencing. element of telemedicine. We talk about, oh, it's so easy. You go into the patient portal right in here. You type in your username and password. You go find the doctor. And at a certain time, you'll go ahead here and you have that conversation. Mm-hmm. Really easy for tech-savvy folks to understand how to do it. You throw in the complexity and you think, oh, well, grandma, you have a tablet. Why don't I use Skype with you? So, you know, I'm going to download Skype and you just another app. You can ask on this. You click on that. And then grandchild two says, well, you know, we're actually on Google Hangouts. We're going to do a session, you know, next week. So, don't worry, it's something different. And for us, it's, okay, go to a different app, right? But really, the user experience would say, go to your contacts, find the person in the video button, and on the back end, it knows you can click all these things. That complexity that we take for granted is already self-integrated into it. When you do that, then those configurations become turnkey. It's so easy for them. You don't really, it's more intuitive than what we would envision. We're very used to the fact that you know, we have created a great tablet experience on companies that built the ability to make it more intuitive as possible. And people are learning, but there's still a gap. Mm-hmm. And that's the reason why companies like Breezy and others have recognized that if we're going to go and close that gap, we're going to have to do more than just simply create a nice looking tablet and hand it to them. And that's where learning about user experience, making those configurations, and really helping them understand the flow of the community. It is, generally speaking, on par, because their tablets are today are coming down in price. Some tablets are more expensive than others. With the software packages and some of the lower expenses, they end up being on par with some of the tablets that you can get today. So I would say cost is always a consideration, especially when you look at the senior population, because whether it's assisted living facility or seniors and family members watching the budget, that will always be a consideration. But today, it really is about understanding if you were to create a platform where you can change it from requiring an individual to support you to being able to do it independently, there's value there. Because now what you've got is to create independence. And then with the independence and the desire for people to actually use this, in fact, we had some seniors that were using just 8 to 12 hours a day. I mean, insane amount. We had one woman who was in a wheelchair. She had a bungee cord attached to the tablet, so she couldn't. She could, even if she dropped it, she could always pick it up. I mean, almost addictive, to this thing, to this new technology, because they've never experienced the internet, Google, Facebook, Amazon, and Skype, and things like that. So for them, it was extraordinarily powerful. Now imagine you've got a platform that's having you present medication reminders to that. Presenting reminders for doctors to do for blood pressure tests. I mean, you need all the stuff that we say take for granted. It's all about where are people's attention. If their attention is focused on the technology that they want to use and they like using, then you've got a perfect opportunity. And that's the opportunity for healthcare to latch on to what people are already doing. Make it easy for them, make it something they want to do, and then weave healthcare into that. As opposed to saying, treat yourself and go to the app and enter this information in. That approach generally doesn't work. Other thoughts or questions?
You talked a little bit about the if you're like an app, you can get like a kind of smartphone. And
Look, it's specifically designed for virtual reality. So the way it works is you can go to the Oculus Play Store, you can download it. It's free, again, so there's no cost to this. You download it, and there's some instructions and there's some video tutorials on YouTube and things like that. If you have individuals that have this, any of these conditions, again, it's a pretty broad range, you can actually have them tested out. And we did some early work here in the States, and we had some pretty amazing results. And it's exciting for folks that have never, and in some cases, they don't have access to some of the abilities to treat this. Sometimes the treatments have not necessarily been effective, but it's really exciting to see. I can tell you many folks have already asked me that have developed this macular degeneration and have been asking, how do I get access to it? Really easy. So, I would encourage you to check it out, and if there are opportunities to test it with individuals, we really take it to the next level and study it and understand the better use cases and bring that feedback to us so we can continue to make this product better. Questions? All right, I think we are out of time. So, Chris, thanks. If you have any other questions, I'm also on LinkedIn, David Rhew, on Twitter, D Rhew. Thank you very much.
Thank you.